So, I was surfing the interwebs the other day, as I usually do. Being a very busy student leads me to procrastinate a lot. But I came across this pretty dank meme. And I don't know if you guys have seen this, but it's a meme where you see an iceberg, and the downer you go on the iceberg, the more obscure the thing becomes. And this theme of this iceberg was a film and filmmaker meme theme. I forgot who made it. I'm gonna look up his name real quick, whoever made it. By the way, I'm gonna cut all this out. This is bad. I should have done my research before. So, it's uploaded by user Sectorpriza. That's the name of the user. And I'm gonna be looking at his iceberg meme. There's plenty of movie iceberg memes out there, but I decided to go with that one. I'm just gonna give my thoughts on everything. It'll be like a more laid-back video of me just sharing my thoughts on random things. Starting at the tip of the iceberg, let's go. So let's start with Star Wars. What are my thoughts on Star Wars? I love the original trilogy, obviously. And, I'm one of those crazy people who actually like the prequels. The prequels are okay. Episode 3 is pretty cool. I don't really like Episode 2. I don't really like the new movies, to be honest. I've yet to see Episode 9. I was kind of disinterested in it. Episode 8... it's like Episode 8 is one of the most frustrating movies ever. You know? Fuck, I need to do an... I'm gonna do a review of Episode 8. But, if I have to sum up Star Wars Episode 8... This is how I put it. This is how I put it to my friends, and they're like, wow, that's very accurate. In improv, when you do improv... The golden rule of improv is that you don't say no, you just say yes. So if someone says, oh, you're in a car, you just go with it. You don't say, I'm not in a car, I'm in a grocery store. I feel like Episode 7 set up a ton of things, and then Rian Johnson, just to be creative, just said no to everything. So, oh, who is Snoke? Who's this mysterious guy? Dies. Oh, who are Rey's parents? Garbage people. Rian Johnson strikes me as the kind of guy who would suck at improv, but it is what it is. MCU, I actually like the MCU quite a bit. There's a few good films in there. Iron Man 3, Guardians of the Galaxy 1 and 2, Captain America 2. Those are like the big four for me. They're hit and miss. Like, I didn't like Doctor Strange. I didn't like Black Panther. I've yet to see Captain Marvel, actually, but it doesn't look like my kind of thing. A lot of people like to hate on superhero movies. I'm not one of those guys. I think the MCU is quite an accomplishment. To think that they kept the audience invested for 23 movies straight and counting is quite a feat that film snobs tend to, like, scoff at the MCU, but... you know what? This is a bold statement, but I'm gonna say it. The way we look back at Empire Strikes Back... We're gonna look back at Infinity War like that. It's like one of those movies. It's just like, and I remember I worked at a high school when I saw Infinity War for the first time, and I was around some students because I was supervising a field trip, and they were just going crazy over that shit. And it's really gonna leave an impact on the younger generation. Unlike the newer Star Wars, where I feel like it's gonna be kind of forgotten, I can see Marvel having some heavy nostalgia in the future, and it's merited. These are really competently made films, for the most part, obviously, like Thor 2, it is what it is, but I have a little Marvel fatigue, not gonna lie. Like, this WandaVision show, I'm not really gonna bother. Yeah, I think it kind of ended beautifully with Endgame. I'm just not gonna watch anymore. Moving on, Titanic. I've done a review of Titanic on this channel back when I was doing the Love-a-thon, so you can check that out. I'm not gonna review it again. Mixed feelings about it overall, but... The Lord of the Rings! Listen, I'm not that big into Lord of the Rings, to be honest. Like, I feel like you have to have read the books in order to appreciate it. On a technical standpoint, it's really well done, don't get me wrong. Anything, and the acting is really good too. It's just, like, the stories, they get so complicated and so convoluted for me that I, like, have a tough time understanding the more human element, the more emotional side to the story, which is, basically a hero's journey. It's the same story as Luke Skywalker in Star Wars, but Star Wars is a basic enough story that you get those human emotions, whereas Lord of the Rings gets a little too big and crazy for me. But if I read the book, I'm sure I'd like the movies a bit more. I do like Fellowship of the Ring. It's starting with Two Towers that I start kind of losing it, and it kind of wins me back when it comes to Return of the King. I just made that connection in my head. Third Star Wars movie is Return of the Jedi, and third Lord of the Rings movie is Return of the King, so I never did that math in my head. Moving on to Forrest Gump. I like Forrest Gump. One of those movies people like to shit on nowadays. Forrest Gump is apple pie, okay? It's good old American apple pie. You just consume it, and it feels good. It makes you feel warm and gooey. It is what it is. So that's the top tier. Moving on down below that, we got some filmmakers here. So I'll just give you my thoughts on each of these filmmakers. Robert Zemeckis. Robert Zemeckis made movies like Back to the Future. And he's been on a bit of a cold streak lately. He made that like weird movie where Steve Carell is a puppet or something. I don't know. But Robert Zemeckis is a good filmmaker. He's made one of my favorite movies of all time, which is Who Framed Roger Rabbit. I love Who Framed Roger Rabbit. Back in the days where these animated films used to be a little more risque, Who Framed Roger Rabbit, it's a lot like Zootopia, if you've seen Zootopia. It explores race relations, but it's told in a family-friendly way. Really clever film. I hear the book is a lot more intense and dives a lot more into those themes of racism, but just from a film standpoint, on a technical level, Who Framed Roger Rabbit is one of the best-looking movies you can find out there. It's crazy good. Steven Spielberg, the best way to describe him is that he's got the brain of an adult but the heart of a child. You watch movies like Indiana Jones and Jaws, they have so much childlike wonder to them. And later in his career, when it came to movies like Schindler's List, and Steven Spielberg, I liked him when he was this childlike wonder, very awe-inspiring filmmaker, and then he just became a more dramatic filmmaker. And like I said, he's a director who has like the mind of an adult but the heart of a child. And as I feel like as the further in his career Spielberg went, the more he started losing that heart of a child, and it just started being his brain overtaking it. Like, I saw Bridge of Spies, and not gonna lie, that movie kind of put me to sleep. I actually did like Ready Player One in some ways, but I feel like, I don't know, I would like to see him do like just like a simple adventure movie. Maybe not Indiana Jones, but just like an adventure movie. But he's getting up there in age, so I don't know. David Fincher is a really fantastic filmmaker in my opinion. Gone Girl, Mank recently, obviously Fight Club, Seven. All these movies are pretty fantastic. David Fincher can do no wrong, in my opinion. He's a fucking badass, is what he is. Christopher Nolan, I did a review of Tenet, and I said this in my review of Tenet, but I'm gonna repeat it again. I feel like people think Christopher Nolan is the next Stanley Kubrick. He is not the next Stanley Kubrick. He works on a different level. He's more of a spectacle guy. You go, you see his movies in the movie theater, and you put popcorn in your face, and you're like, it's thought-provoking, there's so much spectacle to it. He's a bit more like a James Cameron, the way I see it, okay? He's James Cameron, he's not Stanley Kubrick. It's not like his movies, I can spend hours dissecting them. Tenet, probably a bit more so than his other films, but still. Even when he made Interstellar, that was supposed to be his 2001 A Space Odyssey, and even then, it felt a lot less, thought-provoking, which, Interstellar was still thought-provoking, and I really like that movie, but it's not on the same level as a 2001 A Space Odyssey, where people are still talking and interpreting the film up until today. I don't see Christopher Nolan as that, but he's still a solid filmmaker, and when it comes to technicality and cinematography and special effects, I think he's the best probably working nowadays. There's no reason to skip on a Christopher Nolan movie in theaters. You should always go see a Christopher Nolan movie in theaters. So Dark Knight, Dark Knight Rises, Batman Begins, Inception, Interstellar, so many great films. Quentin Tarantino is probably the filmmaker that made me like film. I remember back when I was in probably grade 8, we had to do a movie review project. He had to review a movie in front of the class, and I wanted to review Pulp Fiction because I loved that movie at the time, and I still do. So I asked the teacher, can I review Pulp Fiction? This was for my French class, and the French teacher said, no, you have to watch a French movie. So I decided to watch Denis Villeneuve's Incendie instead, which is still a pretty good movie. But later, when we're doing the presentations a few weeks later, some guy in my class fucking stole my idea and did a presentation on fucking Pulp Fiction. This is a squeaky teen, a squeaky voice teen. Oh, it's a good movie. And I was like, ma'am, what gives? You told me I couldn't do Pulp Fiction. Now you're letting this squeaky teen do Pulp Fiction? Anyway, I was not happy that day. But Quentin Tarantino is a great filmmaker. He kind of lost me a bit with Hateful Eight. I wasn't that big into Hateful Eight. But then he won me again with Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is a great movie. I went to see it with my dad in theaters, and I don't want to embarrass my dad, but he kind of shed a tear. It's such a lovely story. Such a laid-back movie. You just, like, there's very few movies that do that nowadays. Like, I just watched Blade Runner yesterday, and there's few movies that are just slow and let you soak in the atmosphere, the production design. And Once Upon a Time in Hollywood did that. Quentin Tarantino went out of his way to recreate LA in the 1960s, and you just stop and you smell it and you feel like you're there, even though I wasn't alive back then. Tarantino knows how to craft a movie. The problem is, I feel like Tarantino always relies on the same tools of excessive violence and quippy dialogue. Not that there's anything wrong with that, I love excessive violence, but I thought it didn't really fit in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. It was like more of a breezy story, and then all of a sudden it's like Brad Pitt bashing a girl's face in a fucking fireplace, which kind of came out of left field. I wasn't expecting it, but overall, Tarantino has a solid, like Django Unchained. I'm gonna go on a tangent again. Django Unchained, I went to see that movie twice in the cinema when it came out. It's such a fun movie, and it really makes you like, fuck yeah! You know, you walk in and you feel so much like, and that's what it is. It's like a blaxploitation film. It's supposed to make you feel like, fuck yeah. So, moving on to the layer underneath. Stanley Kubrick. So I just talked about Stanley Kubrick when I was talking about Christopher Nolan. Love Stanley Kubrick. My faves from him are Eyes Wide Shut. I love Clockwork Orange, 2001 A Space Odyssey. Those are the essential three in my opinion. You watch those three movies, you go on Reddit, you see every fucking interpretation of it, and you enjoy it. Stanley Kubrick is a legendary filmmaker. I wonder, first of all, he was about to make a movie about Napoleon, and his script leaked online, and I always wanted to read that, but I never got around to it. But more so, I wonder what Stanley Kubrick would be like if he was just around for a little longer. Because he was supposed to do AI, artificial intelligence, but he died halfway through the making of it. And it would be interesting to just see how Stanley Kubrick perceives film nowadays. Because the direction of the film industry has gone in a different direction. A lot more focus on franchise film. Disney having a monopoly on the film industry, in my opinion. I would like to see what Stanley Kubrick would have to say about the current state of the film industry. I'm sure he would have a lot to say. David Lynch. I love me some David Lynch. David Lynch is a very, very artistic, abstract filmmaker. People know him from the TV show Twin Peaks. I've never watched Twin Peaks, to be honest. I'm more of a movie guy. But I have seen most of his films. I've seen Eraserhead is his best film, in my opinion. Blue Velvet is really interesting. Mulholland Drive, very interesting. He makes a lot of abstract films, and he's from, like, Midwest America. I'm not too sure about my American geography. And his films seem to have this recurring theme of, like, this cute little neighborhood with a white picket fence and everyone knows each other, but underneath the surface there's always some dark conspiracy going on. That's the theme with Blue Velvet. That's a, kind of the theme with Mulholland Drive 2, although set in the film industry. Very interesting filmmaker. He's also a really talented, just overall artist. Some of the music he makes is really interesting, if you haven't checked that out. And he paints a lot and stuff like that. He acts in movies as well. He's acted in that Louis C.K. TV show. I remember he played an executive producer on that show. Just an overall very versatile dude and very interesting dude. You see clips of him behind the camera, and he gets so passionate about film, it's actually quite admirable. Sometimes he'll fucking snap at actors.
If you want to cut the time down,
What is this with everybody?
No.
What is it? Really?
It's only me. It's
why? I'm serious. Fucking A, man. It drives me nuts. Who gives a fucking shit how long a scene is?
Oh, what are you doing? What is this? What is this? He will fucking go like that. I love David Lynch. Moving on to Francis Ford Coppola. So, legendary director of The Godfather Part 2, and Apocalypse Now, Bram Stoker's Dracula. I think his best movie is Apocalypse Now. Not dissing on his other films, but I think Apocalypse Now is a fucking masterpiece. Apocalypse Now is not a war movie. It's a fucking epic. It's a movie about death. It's a movie about, like, these grandiose themes. It just happens to be set during the Vietnam War. And Francis Ford Coppola is kind of known for kind of losing his edge later in his career. His last big movie was Bram Stoker's Dracula. And he hasn't made that many great films. Like, the Godfather films, Apocalypse Now, Bram Stoker's Dracula, The Conversation. But other than that, it's not up there, and he's actually made a few flops. But anyone who makes The Godfather is, like, that's an automatic win, you know? So, there's a great documentary about the making of Apocalypse Now, how that was just such a chaotic mess. It's called Hearts of Darkness. If you haven't seen that documentary, I highly recommend it.
Nothing is so terrible as a pretentious movie. I mean, a movie that aspires for something really terrific and doesn't pull it off is shit, it's scum. And everyone will walk on it as such. And that's why poor filmmakers, in a way, that's their greatest horror, is to be pretentious. So here you are, on one hand, it's trying to aspire to really do something. On the other hand, you're not allowed to be pretentious. And finally you say, fuck it. I don't care if I'm pretentious or not pretentious, or if I've done it or I haven't done it. All I know is that I am going to see this movie.
Basically, everything that can go wrong on a film set went wrong. Fucking hurricanes. The best part is they told Marlon Brando he needs to lose weight for the part. He's supposed to lose like 30 pounds. And he comes back and he gained 30 pounds and everyone's freaking out. Marlon Brando was just like, I'm terribly embarrassed about what I've done. But, yeah. Hearts of Darkness is one that will make you appreciate the great Francis Ford Coppola. Moving on to Orson Welles. Orson Welles directed Citizen Kane and starred in Citizen Kane as well. For those of you who don't know, Citizen Kane is the movie in Mank, which is on Netflix now and you should watch because it's a good movie. But he's also made movies like The Third Man and stuff like that. Very good filmmaker, goes without saying. Really interesting dude as well, kind of a badass. I like seeing him in interviews, and he's just like this fat dude smoking a cigar. Pretty cool dude, in my opinion. Denis Villeneuve! So Denis Villeneuve is from my homeland of Quebec. Like I said, I had to do a film review back when I was in grade 8, and I chose Insensé. And it was a really good movie. He's made a lot of great films. He made this movie about a infamous school shooting that happened in Montreal called the Polytechnique shooting. He made a movie about that, and that was a really good movie. He kind of reminds me a bit of a Christopher Nolan when it comes to style, but his movies are a lot more thought-provoking, in my opinion, and it's fun to dissect them. And I think his best movie so far is actually Blade Runner 2049, and I think that's an amazing movie. I also really like Prisoners. There's some movies he's made that I'm a little iffy on. I liked the first half of Arrival, but then the second half, I kind of lost what the film was. The thing is, there's this episode of Star Trek The Next Generation where... This is like the biggest tangent ever, I'm sorry. There's this episode of Star Trek The Next Generation where they're trying to find out what the aliens are trying to say. And the whole episode is them trying to figure out their language because they speak in like this kind of broken English.
Beast of Tanagra. Uzani, his army. Jaka, when the walls fell.
And the first half of Arrival reminded me a lot of that Star Trek episode. But then it kind of became like this weird time travel thing, and I wish the whole movie was them decoding the language because it was so interesting. But other than that, Denis Villeneuve can do no wrong. I've yet to see Sicario, actually, for some reason. I've never seen Sicario, but I've seen every one of his films. Enemy, great film. Prisoners, fuck, the acting in that movie is fantastic. Hugh Jackman in that movie, fucking amazing. I don't know. Terrence Malick directed The Tree of Life, most famously. He's also done movies like Badlands, and most recently he did A Hidden Life. He's a very artistic, one might even say artsy-fartsy filmmaker. Lots of nature shots, shaky camera, kind of looks like the first half of Man of Steel. That's kind of what Man of Steel was ripping off. They were ripping off Terrence Malick. To be honest, I haven't seen many of his films. He kind of has a weird filmography because it spans over so long, but he hasn't made many films, but he's been around for a long time. His best film is by far Days of Heaven. Days of Heaven is a fantastic film, but that's what I mean, is a breezy, take it in, like, natureful director, and I kind of like that about him. It's not really my go-to style, but every now and then I'll appreciate that kind of film. So, and Tree of Life is another good movie. I think Tree of Life got some backlash when it came out for being too pretentious. I didn't think it was pretentious at all. I think it was just a good movie. But Paul Thomas Anderson. So Paul Thomas Anderson is a pretty cool filmmaker. He's married to one of those girls on SNL. What was her name? Maya Rudolph. He's married to Maya Rudolph. And he worked a lot with Daniel Day-Lewis making movies like Phantom Thread and There Will Be Blood, which are two fantastic films. But in the earlier part of his career, he made Boogie Nights, which is more of like a what was coming out in the 90s, just like some quick dialogue, groovy, like hangout movie. And then as his career progressed, the more and more the film started becoming artistic. So he made Magnolia next, which is another great movie. Tom Cruise in that movie is fantastic. And then he made other films, Punch Drunk Love. I really like Punch Drunk Love. He worked a lot with Philip Seymour Hoffman, too, and he's a fantastic actor. And Paul Thomas Anderson's best movie is The Master. The Master is the best. When you want to see good acting, go see The Master, and there's so much you can dissect in that movie. It's one of those movies, it's about like a war vet who has PTSD, and he joins this kind of cult that's on a boat, and Philip Seymour Hoffman is like the L. Ron Hubbard of the boat. And if you guys thought Joaquin Phoenix was good in The Joker, wait till you see him in The Master. Such a fantastic movie. He pays a lot of attention to detail. The cinematography in his films are always on point. Like, there's so many shots in his films that are burnt into my brain. Like, when I think of There Will Be Blood, I think of that shot of the oil drill on fire. And when I think of The Master, I just think of the shots of him on the beach, or the shot of him and Philip Seymour Hoffman in the jail, and Joaquin Phoenix is banging his head on the bed while Philip Seymour Hoffman is like more calm.
Ah!
him. It has so much... He can tell a story and themes of a story so visually. He's a beautiful, beautiful director. I love it. He's made a few films I'm not a fan of. I didn't like Inherent Vice. But that's what happens when you're a risk taker, you know? Sometimes you make movies, it doesn't really please everyone. Alfred Hitchcock. I've seen most of Alfred Hitchcock's filmography. I bought a box set that had all of the Alfred Hitchcock films in it. And the highlights to me are... I really liked Vertigo. Vertigo and Rear Window and Psycho. Those are the three best to me. I don't think his films aged particularly well. And I'm a film buff, and this channel is full of film buffs, I'm assuming. But I'm just honest with you guys. Alfred Hitchcock is not one of those filmmakers I go out of my way and watch, unlike something like a Paul Thomas Anderson. His movies are very of their time. They feel very stage-like. Even Rope is all done with one camera angle, and it's just them in front of the camera. He has a very stage-like... It's what film was back then. And that's fine and all, but it's not what I go for when I watch film. So I have seen much of Alfred Hitchcock's filmography. I do respect him. I do understand his influence on the film as a medium. But his films didn't age particularly well, in my opinion. With the exception of the three I named. There's some movies, it's like... Yeah, I wouldn't recommend it to your average dude. I lumped these three together. Jean-Luc Godard. Oh, we're at the next layer, by the way. Layer underneath, by the way. So now we're getting pretty down in our iceberg. So I lumped these three guys together. Jean-Luc Godard, François Truffaut, and Robert Bresson. Those are three filmmakers that are part of the what's called French New Wave movement. So like I said before, Alfred Hitchcock, his films feel a certain way, and it's that reflective of that era. And then French New Wave came along, and it kind of just broke a lot of rules. The most recent French New Wave film I watched was actually Une Femme est une Femme, which was Jackie that recommended that movie for me. And it's such a different film. Like, there's audio problems in that movie. Like, the music goes in and out, the audio goes in and out, the camera does whatever the fuck it wants. I don't think the movie had a solid script. So a lot of it was just like, hey, let's take the rules of film, throw it outside of the window, and let's try to do something a little different. Let's try to, like, make a movie off the seam of our pants here. So that's what these three filmmakers are most known for, is doing that. I have a huge blind spot in my film repertoire when it comes to French New Wave. I really should get on that. Andrei Tarkovsky, one of my favorite filmmakers. This guy, if you guys at home like Stanley Kubrick, I need to recommend Andrei Tarkovsky to you. So, interesting dude. He made films during the USSR, and smoked like a chimney, died of lung cancer, by the way. But his films feel very, very attention to detail oriented, and it's like a Stanley Kubrick. There's so much you can fucking dissect with his movies, it's actually fantastic. Andrei Rublev is one of his best films, has so much to do with, like, religion and following a religion and the feeling that you get when you break the codes of that religion. Then you have movies like Solaris and Stalker, and those are just odd dystopian sci-fi films with, like, these big heady themes to them. If you guys aren't familiar with Tarkovsky, I suggest you look at him. Another thing is that he was a very religious filmmaker, and during that time, during Russian communism and the USSR, it was very frowned upon to be religious, so a lot of the movies he did was going against the USSR, so that's why he makes a lot of movies about religion. Very interesting filmmaker. I suggest you watch those three films that I named and see if you like. He's also made other films like Offret and The Mirror, which are also two fantastic films. The Mirror is a little complicated. I needed to watch that twice, but... Next, Akira Kurosawa. So Akira Kurosawa is a Japanese filmmaker. He was the main influence for Star Wars. So George Lucas was heavily inspired by Star Wars when he came to make... who was heavily influenced by, I think, Yojimbo when he made Star Wars. Or a lot of films by Akira Kurosawa. Very interesting filmmaker. He basically laid the groundwork of the samurai film, which would later blossom into the Western. So he made the movie Seven Samurai, that would later be remade in America, but it was remade as The Magnificent Seven. So his movie Yojimbo would later become A Fistful of Dollars, which was directed by Sergio Leone, who I'm surprised is not on this iceberg, but whatever. And heavy influence when it comes to American film, even though he was a Japanese filmmaker. His best movie, in my opinion, is Ran. Ran is such like a grandiose, like all-out samurai film with big themes like betrayal and stuff like that. And the action scenes are so great in it. I remember the colorful clothing and the battles going on with the colorful clothing and stuff like that. Great cinematography in that film, so if I had to throw you a recommendation of Akira Kurosawa, it would be Ran. Federico Fellini, he was heavily influenced the director Martin Scorsese. He's an Italian filmmaker. He's most known for his movie 8 and a Half. He's a very dreamlike filmmaker. His movies kind of feel like dreams, and they kind of feel Italian, you know? Has that Italian vibe where you have like shots lingering on like a town square, like St. Marco's Square, and there's like a little boy playing with a soccer ball with a dog, and you're just like, ah, Italia, kind of thing. But his movies also had deeper themes as well. The movie Dolce Vita had a theme of like excessive lifestyle and stuff like that, and 8 and a Half had a theme of heart, like being obsessed with your art, and Amarcord is another good movie he's made. Fellini, you can see the influence Fellini had on directors Martin Scorsese when you watch their movies back to back. If I had to throw you one recommendation, watch Dolce Vita. That's one of the most beautiful films ever made. It kind of feels like a party. The whole movie feels like a party, and the party like starts winding down and people start leaving, and it's just a very poetic film. Moving down even more the iceberg. So, Nicholas Winding Refn. Nicholas Winding Refn is an interesting filmmaker. Very current filmmaker, unlike the ones we've named before. So he's made movies like Drive is his most famous film. But he's also made another film I really enjoy. Two other films, actually. I love Bronson, which is a movie about a prison brawler. And I like the movie... why am I blanking on the name all the time? The Neon Demon. I like The Neon Demon a lot. It's like a movie about how the fashion industry is like fucking crazy and shit, and it's like this abstract movie. Nicholas Winding Refn is known for having like a kind of 80s synth vibe to it. His movies feel very 80s, very colorful, lots of lighting and stuff like that. His films are also very graphically violent. You will look at a movie like Drive where Ryan Gosling is just beating a guy's head in an elevator and turns it into mashed potatoes. Very violent, very 80s. Even the music in his movies is like has that 80s synthwave vibe. But he's a really interesting filmmaker. Kind of a dick in real life. Like, I get a major dick vibe from this guy. And there's this infamous interview of him with William Friedkin where Refn is saying that Only God Forgives, which is a kind of mediocre movie in his filmography. He says Only God Forgives is like a masterpiece that should be compared to 2001 A Space Odyssey. And I'm like, hell to the no! But that's just me. And so was William Friedkin. He kind of put him in his place.
When you were mentioning 2001 A Citizen Kane, you forgot to add Drive. But we'll let that slip.
We won't know about Drive for another 30 years.
30 seconds.
Whether it lives or dies. I'm talking about films. 2001 was made in 1968.
I made this film about 4 years ago. So it's about
4 years is a zip. It's not even a blip. It's not a pimple on the asshole of humanity.
But overall, Nicholas Winding Refn is pretty interesting. He recently made a TV show for HBO, but I'm not a big TV guy. I just watch movies, so the last movie he's made, Neon Demon, was pretty cool. Aleksei Balabanov. I can't say that. His filmography is actually pretty short-lived. He died very young, but he's an ex-Soviet officer, and he became a filmmaker. I haven't seen any movies in his filmography, I just know him by name, but from what it sounds, he's very similar to Lars von Trier, who I am very familiar with. Lars von Trier is a very controversial filmmaker. He kind of just says whatever's on his mind in interviews. Some people have accused him of being a Nazi sympathizer. Some people have accused him of being an anti-feminist. His movies kind of speak for themselves. Lars von Trier is known for having a long battle with depression, which is why his filmography is a little sporadic. He's made movies like Dancer in the Dark with Björk, which is a pretty interesting movie. Björk and Radiohead made the soundtrack of that movie, and it just feels a little... I didn't like the movie, but it's definitely an interesting watch. He's also one of the founders of what's called the Dogma 95 movement. The Dogma 95 movement is a set of rules that were created by Lars von Trier and his partner. And the rules were stuff like the camera can't go away from the main character. You have to use natural lighting. It has to be filmed in a certain time frame. So it was like a list of rules that filmmakers had to follow and had to make movies in that fit that criteria in order to be considered Dogma 95, which is kind of his trademark stamp, I guess. But other than that, Lars von Trier, his most interesting film to me is Antichrist. The story of Antichrist is that he was supposed to make like a more straightforward horror film, and about the time where he was making the film, he had to check into a mental hospital because his depression was getting so severe. And when he came out, he made Antichrist. It's this very dark, depressing, disturbing film, but it doesn't feel like torture porny, unlike some films I'm gonna name here. But it's a very difficult watch, like very graphic, like genital mutilation in that film. Not a pleasant watch, but a definitely an interesting and well done film. He's also made Melancholia, which I actually enjoyed quite a bit as well. I didn't like the Nymphomaniac movies, but overall, I think he's a very interesting filmmaker. He definitely takes risks, and that's what I can respect by him. And I would say in his filmography, there's more movies that I didn't like than I did like, but that's what happens when you're such a risk taker. It's I also didn't mention Dogville. I've yet to see Dogville. Every time I go to watch it, it's like I'm not in the mood to watch it. Because the whole movie is told on a stage. It's like you're watching a play. And I'm like never in the mood to like get into that vibe. Even though I know I should, but... Moving on to Gaspar Noé. Gaspar Noé is a French filmmaker. He's known for making Enter the Void, Love, and most recently he made Climax. His movies feel like very... Like, they're very drug-influenced. He's a very drug-influenced filmmaker. He tries to recreate the feel of what a bad trip would feel like. When you watch a movie like Climax, the story of that movie is that a bunch of dancers, one of them spikes LSD in the punch, and they all start bad tripping on LSD. The whole movie just feels like a huge bad trip on LSD, and you know this guy has actually tried doing that, and... It feels legit like you're bad tripping. It's a really well done film. It was one of my favorite movies of that year. Very interesting filmmaker, very opinionated as well. He's talked about how much he thinks Black Panther is a shitty film. He's like, everyone tells me to watch the new Star Wars. I watch it, it's terrible.
I mostly get bored by comedies, action movies, science fiction movies. They're so predictable. I tried Black Panther. I escaped from the cinema after 20 minutes. I thought it was as bad as Star Wars. I hated Star Wars. I hated the R&B music. It was the music was so bad that I had to escape.
That's what he sounds like. Very interesting filmmaker. Enter the Void is his other, is probably his most famous film. That one's pretty good too. Roman Polanski. So Roman Polanski has been in the news a lot, but people don't know his films, so let's just talk about his controversy. So Roman Polanski, I don't really know the story of what he did, to be honest, but I know it involved statutory rape. So I think he like drugged and raped someone who was under 18, which is terrible. But that aside, Roman Polanski also had a very troubled life. He was born in a concentration camp, and his family escaped the concentration camp. And also, he was the husband of Sharon Tate at the time she got murdered. So the infamous Manson family murders. They murdered Sharon Tate, who was his wife, and his unborn child as well was murdered in that incident as well. So it kind of leads you to like be like, yeah, I can see why someone would be that fucked up after something like that would happen. Doesn't like excuse him for doing what he did, but it's like, it really puts it in perspective of how mental, like, your mental health works. If like so much shit happens to you, like you just go down a downward spiral, which is what happened with Roman Polanski. Again, not forgiving what he did was awful, but the dude's had a troubled life, needless to say. But talking about his film now, I think his best film in his filmography is Repulsion. I love Repulsion. I think it's his greatest film. He's also made other crazy good movies. Rosemary's Baby is fantastic. The Pianist is pretty good. Chinatown, that's the one I'm forgetting. I fucking love Chinatown too. So Chinatown is also a very good, very noir feeling movie. But his crown jewel is definitely Rosemary's Baby, I would say. It's considered a horror classic. Very dark, disturbing film, very eerie. And I can say that about Repulsion as well. It's just a very eerie movie. So I really like the movies of Roman Polanski, despite what he's done. I'm able to separate the art from the artist a bit more than your average viewer. So I enjoy the films of Roman Polanski. Moving down the iceberg, we're getting pretty down there. Tom Six. We're getting to that point, guys. Tom Six. Tom Six is the director of the legendary trilogy, The Human Centipede. Now, unlike most people, guys, unlike most people, I'm not like most people out there, I think the first Human Centipede is actually a pretty good movie. It's fucked up of me, but it's like, it really sends shivers down my spine, like, what if some creepy dude kidnapped you and, like, forced you into this, like, fucked up sex act? I don't know. It was pretty scary. Then after that, it just became, like, kind of, it kind of knew what it was, and it just, like, I don't know. Like, the second movie is pretty bad. The premise of the second movie opens with the main character watching the first movie, which is, like, a stupid thing. And this guy kidnaps 12 people and does like a 12 people human centipede with them. Or it was more than 12 people. It was like a ton of people. One of them was like a pregnant woman and she goes through labor while being in the human centipede. No, sorry. She gives birth while driving a car. Or I can't remember. But I just remember she was in the car and she had the baby in the car with her. And she goes to press on the gas but she accidentally crushes the baby's skull instead. So, yeah, that's The Human Centipede for you. The first movie is a bit of a litmus test to see what you can handle. I wouldn't recommend the second movie. It's just, there's, like, scenes where he's, like, masturbating with, like, sandpaper, and you're just like, what the fuck am I watching? Alejandro Jodorowsky. Great filmmaker, in my opinion. I love Alejandro Jodorowsky. So, just like we talked about how Gaspar Noé tries to recreate drug hallucinations and stuff like that, so does Jodorowsky, but they're kind of the antithesis of one another. Gaspar Noé kind of feels like a bad trip, whereas Alejandro Jodorowsky is like this flowery, beautiful LSD trip. You will look at movies like El Topo and movies like The Holy Mountain, and he's even made movies more recently, which is pretty cool because he's 92 years old now, and he's made movies in his 80s. He looks like he's in good health. I've seen videos of him recently. He looks like he's in really good health. If you guys haven't seen any movies by Alejandro Jodorowsky, and you're a little hesitant on watching those movies because they are just like abstract imagery, not a solid story through line, I would recommend watching the documentary Jodorowsky's Dune. You kind of get an idea of who this director is and what his vibe is. And if you like that vibe, then you can go watch his movies. So the movie Jodorowsky's Dune is a documentary about how, before Denis Villeneuve is about to do it, Alejandro Jodorowsky was supposed to make a Dune movie back in the 70s. And it was this big ambitious project where it was going to cost millions of dollars. It was going to feel like this acid trip. There was people lined up to play in it, like Pink Floyd was going to make the music, David Bowie was going to play in it, Orson Welles was going to play in it, and you kind of see the anatomy of how it all crumbled. And it kind of crumbled and became a bunch of different movies, like Star Wars and Flash Gordon and Alien, and you could kind of get the spirit of Jodorowsky, and he's a very charismatic person, and when he talks about film, he's so fucking passionate about film, you have to admire it.
This system make of us slaves, without dignity, without depth, no? With a devil in our pocket, this incredible money, I in the pocket, this money, this shit, this nothing, this paper who have nothing inside. Movies have heart, boom, boom. Boom, have mind, have power, have ambition. I wanted to do something like that. Why not?
So watch that documentary, and if you get an idea of, if you feel like you're going to like that kind of thing, I suggest you watch The Holy Mountain in El Topo. There's a scene in Holy Mountain where the guy is squirting milk from his tits, and his tits are like lions, and he's just like screaming and squirting titty milk through his lion nipples. Kind of a crazy dude, but you gotta love it. Oh my god, I've been here for an hour. Holy mackerel. Next, Salo in the 120 Days of Sodom. This was directed by Pasolini, who's an Italian filmmaker. He's known for making the movie The Gospel According to St. Matthew. And then he made Salo 120 Days of Sodom. It's a movie that's very dark and disturbing. It's supposed to be a cautionary tale about fascism in Italy, which was pretty relevant at the time because you're fresh off of World War II. But it's not a pleasant watch. I wouldn't recommend it. A lot of rape, a lot of scat. It's just not a fun watch. And to be honest, I don't even really like the movie. I don't think it's a competently... It's competently made, but it's just like... It didn't need to go that far. It just feels very gross. It's not a fun movie to watch. I'm not one of these guys. I'm a bloodhound. I like seeing gore in films. But once I start seeing rape and scat, that's kind of where I start, like, getting a little nauseous. I'm getting nauseous just thinking of it. But yeah, this movie was supposed to be... It's about, a bunch of socialites in Italy who take under a bunch of students. And they make the students do weird stuff to each other, like, eat each other's poo and have sex with one another. And yeah... Not a fun movie. Not a fun movie. We're at the bottom of this iceberg now. So, a Serbian film. A Serbian film is not a movie you should watch. It's a very fucked up movie. My brother made me watch it. It's about a porn star who's about to retire. And there's one guy who says, just make one more movie for me. Just one more project. And he chooses to accept it. And he makes him do a bunch of gross sex acts. And it's not a good movie because it's just, like, some fucked up dude, like, thinking of the grossest things ever and putting it on film. There's literally nothing else to it. There's not, like, deep characters or, like, a story or a message or a theme. It's literally just gross sex acts being done. and the ending really traumatized me. The ending was very fucked up to this movie. I'm gonna spoil it, so, because you shouldn't watch this movie, it's not a good movie. So, the ending of this movie is basically, he's under the influence of a ton of drugs, and they say, have sex with this one last thing and we're done. And he's under the influence of so many things, he doesn't know what he's having sex with. It turns out he's having sex with his 4-year-old boy, which is fucked up. Like, don't watch this movie. It's not... I know, I look like a fucking pussy. I know there's people on the internet who's like, oh, did you see Serbian film? That movie's fucked up. I'm like, dude, that's fucking gross. Stop showing me that shit. I don't want to see that. Alright, next. The Green Elephant is a bit the same deal as that. It's from 1999. It's this psychedelic horror movie where there's like two Russian prisoners and they're like in a room together and they're forced to do some fucked up shit to each other. Kind of like Salo in some ways. And again, a lot of scat, a lot of rape. Not much to it, in my opinion. Pink Flamingos. Now we're getting into some actual interesting movies, not just some gross scat shit. So Pink Flamingos was directed by, what's his name? John Waters. I was about to say Roger Waters, because we're talking about Pink Floyd. No, it's directed by John Waters, which most people don't know him by name, but he created Hairspray, the musical. And in the 70s, he was a very counterculture filmmaker, so his movies, they felt a very, like, punk rock vibe. And he was punk rock before punk rock was actually a thing. John Waters, he's also in the LGBTQ community, and he's had a lot of gay pride and themes of sexual pride in his films. He always used to collaborate with Divine, who is a crossdresser, and the Pink Flamingos is the movie that put him on the map. One might think that it's a movie like Salo, or maybe not Salo, but a movie like a Serbian film where it's just gross for the sake of being gross. But it has a bit more of a purpose to it. It just feels so weird and stylized. And it's such a, like, an interesting movie to watch nowadays and say, like, how did this come out in 1972? But that's what it was. It was punk rock before punk rock was a thing. And I love the monologue that Divine delivers in this movie. Where she says, kill everyone now!
Kill everyone now! Condone first-degree murder! Advocate cannibalism! Eat shit! Filth are my politics! Filth is my life! Take whatever you like! Yes.
An interesting movie. This isn't the kind of movie a first-time John Waters person should watch, though. I would suggest the movie that captures John Waters the best. If I had a friend and they said, I don't know John Waters, can you show me a John Waters movie? Watch Polyester. Polyester is such a funny movie, and it's like kind of like poking fun of like the like stereotypes of a sitcom family, like the mom who stays at home, the dad who's off to work, the son who does this. It's just kind of a parody where all's going wrong and the mom's having like an emotional breakdown. And that's what he is. He's taking the norms of the 1960s and, like, flipping them on their head. So, unlike the other movies I've just named, it's not just, like, gross for the sake of being gross. Although, this movie does have scat in it. this is the only movie on this list who that has real-life scat, okay? Because the other movies is just, like, a mountain of, like, chocolate, like, some kind of Nutella, I guess. But this movie went for it. They did some real-life scat in this, which is pretty nasty. But, unironically, the one with the real scat is the one that kind of upset me the least. I wonder how much that says about my personality. Moving on to Vas de Noces. So, that's... I haven't seen this movie, to be honest, because it's infamously known in the film buff community as the pig fucking movie. It's a movie where a guy falls in love with a pig and has sex with the pig. Came out in 1974, by the way. It's banned in a lot of countries. It's banned in Australia, I think, banned in New Zealand. I'm not interested in watching this movie. There's an episode of Black Mirror, I think it was the first episode of the series, where the president of the United States had to have sex with a pig. And you can add bestiality to that list of things that kind of just, like, gross me out. I know I'm gonna watch it because I'm a curious individual at the end of the day, but I'm just never in the mood for it. Like, there's like scenes where he's rolling around in pig shit and stuff like that, and then he has sex with the pig. It's like, I should have added that to my romantic film marathon. Just have a movie where the guy has sex with a pig. All right, moving down, Tommy Wiseau. Unironically, Tommy Wiseau directed The Room, which is hailed as the biggest so bad it's good movie. I don't think I'll ever like Tommy Wiseau unironic. Actually, you know what? I think I know what this guy is getting at. You look at Tommy Wiseau in interviews, and he's kind of just a lovable dude. Like, you kind of want to go to him and give him a hug. He's kind of like a... He just seems like he's so into what he's doing, and he kind of comes across as like a fraud or like a sleazy car salesman, but he's just so into what he does that it's like, fuck. I think I know where this guy is getting at with the liking Tommy Wiseau unironically. It goes more with his persona and who he is as a person more so than his actual film, because the dude is pretty much a walking meme. Like, everything he does is meme content. Next, Begotten. So Begotten is actually another very terrifying, traumatic film, but this one's actually pretty well done. Begotten is an abstract movie that was all filmed on Super 8. Let me just look up the filmmaker real quick. So it was directed by Edmond Elias Marriage, who's only made a few films. He's made this movie, and the other big movie he made was Shadow of the Vampire with John Malkovich and Willem Dafoe. Which, that movie is pretty good. It's about, like, the filming of the original Nosferatu, and they actually cast a real vampire to make the movie, and it's a bit of, like, a dark horror comedy. It was a pretty interesting watch, but this was the movie he made before, The Begotten, or just Begotten, and it's all filmed on Super 8, and it's a very abstract film about the birth of life. It's a bit of the story of Adam and Eve. It's a bit of the story of Mother Earth. It's kind of like what that movie Mother was trying to do, only, in my opinion, better. I actually like this movie quite a bit. That opening scene is, like, probably one of the most traumatic film scenes ever. But it's weird. It's like a very surreal, gory, but somewhat beautiful film. I'm looking at the film summary of this. It's about man's abuse of nature and nihilistic outlook at what life ultimately is. And that's the perfect description of what the movie is. I enjoy this movie quite a bit. I watched it with my dad, and he did not dig it, and I don't blame him. That was kind of a dick move of me to make him watch this movie. Not a pleasant watch, but definitely an interesting one. And unlike movies like a Serbian film, it doesn't just feel like gross for gross sake. Lucifer Valentine. Lucifer Valentine is not his real name. It's an unknown filmmaker who goes by the pseudonym of Lucifer Valentine. And he's infamous for creating a subgenre of horror film called the... This is gonna gross you out, but he makes movies surrounding vomit. Horror movies about vomit. Which, I mean, to each their own. I'm not gonna fucking watch. I mean, sometimes there's filmmakers, it's like, when you watch a movie like Begotten, it's like, I know what you're going for. When I watch a movie like Pink Flamingos, I'm like, I know what you're going for. So it makes me kind of forgive the scat scene in that movie, in Pink Flamingos. But when I watch a movie and it's just, like, people puking on one another or, like, eating each other's shit and there's not much else to it, I'm just like, dude, like, do this on your own time. You don't have to, like, make it a movie for everyone. Like, just get two consenting adults, have them do what you want to do, and just keep it in a safe in your house and, like, pop it in the DVD player whenever you want. You don't have to make me watch it. What the fuck? There's Two Girls, One Cup on the internet. You can go watch that if you want. Fuck. You don't have to drag me into this shit. But, yeah, so if you're into vomit gore films, I suggest you watch the films of one Lucifer Valentine. And that's it. I went through the whole iceberg. Let me know what are your thoughts on some of these guys. If you want me to do another iceberg video, I'm sure there's others out there on the internet. Other than that, take care, guys.